Do not adjust your TV sets. You are not seeing double. If you watch my channel, you may be wondering why am I showing this radio again. It's because there was a gentleman who brought by two of these. One was his, and the other he wanted to donate, and in exchange for me restoring his personal set. It's a Telefunken Concertino. I believe it's from 1962 or thereabouts. I'm trying to remember the facts about this guy. All right, so it's a Concertino model 5384W. And I'm curious about this. The one that he donated, I think, has a stereo decoder. I'm not sure if this one has it. We'll find out when I remove the back. But I'm going to restore this while the iron's hot, and I remember how I did the last one. So probably the second time around, it'll go much more smoothly than the first time around, because then you have to figure out stuff. I do remember that the chassis are separate. There's a power chassis with the rectifier and stuff, and then there's and the transformer, and then there's the tuner and the amp chassis. And those come out separately, and everything's plugged in together, so a little easier than, say, Grundig, where everything's soldered in, and you have to remember where everything goes. Yep, it's the same story inside as the last one I did, except I've noticed this one is missing. Well, I don't think whoever owned it before, who bought it originally, elected to get the optional FM decoder chassis. It would have been stuck to the back, but it's nowhere to be found. And looky here, actually, it's missing the stereo decoder plug. So this, it's supposed to be down here. All right, well, I guess I can't. What I was going to do is ask the owner if he wanted me to exchange the stereo decoder on the other one over there on the left. This doesn't have the ability to plug it in. It doesn't seem like that was an option for this guy yet. Oh well. But what you need to do on these guys, first of all, there's a lot of dust bunnies, is remove these two individual chassis. You have the tuner chassis and the power chassis. And there's all these little plugs that plug in. There's also some that go underneath. And they're... What I tend to do is I'll take pictures of how this stuff is inserted. You think you'll remember, but then when it comes back to reassembling, you'll forget. I did that last time. And so after I start filming, I'll do that, because I probably lost the pictures. There's four screws holding this in, and a few holding this guy in. Be really careful when you remove this, because this... It's made out of really thin phenolic plastic. It's super brittle. So don't try to jerk or yank on anything. Just be real gentle with it. I'm looking in here. It looks like... Yeah, there's quite a few paper caps in here. These are not fun because it's a early PC board. And what I tend to do is I'll just cut the leads at the cap and then solder to those leads. That worked in the last set I did. If you would watch the last episode, you would know what I'm talking about. But anyway, I'm going to remove these chassis and then take them outside and get the paintbrush and leaf blower and try to get all this dust off first. I'm going to take this moment to show a little helpful hint. If you guys ever come across a German set like one of these that has not been worked on in a long time, and I suspect this one's never actually been worked on ever, because all the connections came off really snug and tight. Sometimes you'll run into an example, you'll take the bolts and screws out of it, and it won't budge. And here's what you need to do. They always put them on these rubber mounts, and the mounts solidify and harden, and it can cause the chassis to stick. So just get a little screwdriver, and it should pop right off. Well, it looks like the front's maybe stuck a little bit too. But, all right, it's free. I can tell I'm going to have to take this out before I get this out, because the huge long glass plate here extends across, so I can't pull it out because this is in the way. And it's always a challenge sometimes working these guys, because like it's hard to even handle that without potentially breaking something. So you just got to make sure and grab hold of the beefiest parts when you pull it out so you don't damage anything. Okay, well, I pulled the chassis up. And I mean, it's dusty, but it seems like it's remarkably clean. There's no accumulated filth or grease or anything like that. So what I'm going to do is get my paintbrush out. First, I'm going to do a cursory cleaning with my battery-powered leaf blower. By the way, when I was a kid, anything that ran on two-cycle gas, especially growing up in Tennessee where it got cold sometimes, just like pull your arm out of the socket trying to start the damn things. But now we have electric, so you just like squeeze the trigger and go to town. See, that already made a huge difference. But what I want to do is get the soft paintbrush so I can dislodge the stuff that's stuck and blow that out. All right, well, I've succeeded in cleaning both chassis, and I think cleaning actually sometimes gives me an idea of like the overall health of a set. And my guess from looking at this, how pristine everything is and how there's not a lot of wear, as in like the print is not immediately rubbing off of the tubes, especially the output tubes. I think it's a low hour set. I think it was not used that much and it was put away a long time ago. There's no like weird oozing or puffing of the electrolytic capacitor. Now my cap check needs to actually recharge. It's the battery's dead. Actually, considering testing the electrolytic, I bet that is totally fine. So I'm tempted to leave that alone. But on the other hand, all these little paper caps, I don't trust those at all. Those leak like crazy. Now it's real tricky here, because if you look, I'm not sure if you can see what my flashlight is showing. This capacitor looks like a paper capacitor, but it's, if you look at the end, it's clear plastic. That's totally fine. There's nothing wrong with that. That's a essentially a plastic sealed capacitor. These guys, on the other hand, you see how there's like crap oozing out of the end? It kind of looks like chalk. That is basically a paper cap that has a poor design for the seals at the end. That's what took forever for people to figure out how to make capacitors reliable. They changed the material to plastic, and they also changed the film in the caps to plastic as well versus paper and foil. So there's quite a few of those in this set. There's, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Not a lot. And I think there's some underneath too. I think there's a grand total of about 10 paper caps that need to be replaced. There's also some electrolytics that have some high power on them. This one and that one have quite a bit of a voltage on them. If it's low voltage electrolytics, I'm not as concerned about it, but these guys have high voltage, so they need to be replaced as well. I see we have I can't remember what the rating on this thing is. What is the microfarad rating? 4 microfarads, 350 volts, and this other one is 2 microfarads at 350 volts. Get rid of them! I'll replace both of those. And what I'm also going to do is, I'm pretty sure these output tubes, what are you? I think it's an ECL86. They're very expensive. So I take these out before I start doing any work, and I put them safely away, because breaking one of those would be $50. Okay, so I've just started the process. I've replaced 2 of these electrolytics and 1 of the paper caps. And you see what I'm doing here is I essentially like clip the lead as close as I can from the original cap, basically. Not focusing properly anyway, and try to save as much of the lead coming out of the board as possible so that you can solder to it. That seems to work well for me with thinning these chassis. I feel like some of the German manufacturers had a difficult time transitioning over to PC board designs, because a lot of it still is very reminiscent of like hand wired stuff, and it's not easy to service whatsoever. But still was a lot of early like PC board stuff, so whatever. It was a time period, a transitioning time period, where many repairmen were probably very frustrated when they had to work on some of this stuff. Okay, so the caps top side have all been replaced. And granted, there's something really key here to notice. Some of these that look like paper caps are not. You see this guy here, it's hard to tell in the video, but it's got a clear end. That means it's polystyrene plastic or film plastic. It's totally fine. There's a bunch of caps underneath here for the tone controls, so we need to replace those as well. And we can just tip it up like so. We have two here. And those don't need to be replaced. This is, again, I can tell you see it's kind of clear on the ends. That's polystyrene, so there's really only two here. I think this might be a newer version of the one I previously worked on, because this was all, I mean, this was paper on this side. Okay, so now that we got these two caps replaced, it's time to start working on freeing up the controls. Unfortunately, a lot of the bearing surfaces in this are seized. Whatever goo they used on these things, the grease just solidifies. So for example, this tone control won't budge, and neither will that one. And I'm not even sure about the tuning mechanism. I'll have to check it out. Let's see. Seems like the tuning condensers are okay. They're a little stiff. They need to be freed up a little bit. That's okay. But the tone controls are my biggest concern. So what I'm going to do is heat the shafts up with some heat, obviously. It's a redundant statement. And then maybe use a little zoom spout oil to work it into the bearing surfaces and hopefully free it up a little bit. Okay, so here's what I'm doing here. You see I'm using my soldering iron. And I'm just going to kind of like heat up all around the shaft area of this pot, because that's where it's getting stuck. Be careful not to hit the plastic, because then you'll melt it, obviously. But you just want to like park the iron here for a little bit, and maybe occasionally add a little bit of light oil to penetrate inside that bearing surface. Well, these are really stuck. Really stuck. I sat here for 20 minutes applying my soldering iron here, and it's just, it barely moves. And I think the only way I'm going to be able to free this up is I need to take the front glass off, these knobs off, and apply maybe a little bit of my plumbing torch heat to it, because I just can't get it to move. It's annoying, but that's what I need to do. I know from experience that usually when these won't free up with a little bit of encouragement, that the grease has essentially turned into glue and needs to be boiled out. All right, so what I'm gonna do is, and again, you gotta be very careful when you do this, because if you get this anywhere near plastic, you can cause a problem. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna heat up the shaft here, a little bit of flame from my plumbing torch. I've got it turned down very low. So what I want to do is get that kind of hot, and then see. Yeah, that's all it took. See, that's already moving a lot better. So I just put a little bit of zoom spout oil in there, and that'll soak in there via capillary action. Let's see. Not the most accurate way of, still a little stiff, but it's getting better. But I'll do that to both sides, this one and that one, and work them back a whole bunch and get them nice and loose. Okay, so now both of these are moving really nicely. I can twist it with my fingers, which is good. So now what we need to do is start addressing some of the other bearing surfaces. For example, the FM tuning condenser bearing surface, as well as the AM and shortwave tuning condenser bearing surfaces, which are up here. And then what I also do is like just barely touch up the pulleys. Do you have to do it? Probably not. It's nylon. It's meant to wear. But it just makes like the tuning sensation so much nicer, much more smooth. Likewise, we have this huge flywheel here, so we're going to oil the bearing behind it. And we'll get the bearing surface back here as well. There we go. It's already feeling a lot better. It's like what you want to do is have this so loose that the flywheel kind of gives you like this sort of nice cushion between stations. Yep, that's feeling a lot better. It'll feel better when I put the knobs on. By the way, I spent like an hour looking for part of knob hardware. There was one of these rings like fell off. And I've spent the last hour digging around my garage floor looking for it. So I think I'm going to have to make an improvement, basically, maybe. What I'm going to have to do is put a piece of metal here. Run it flat here so we have a good, like, contact surface for the lobe here. It's bad. I feel like when things disappear on my shop floor, I don't see them for years later. Okay, so I fabricated a new piece of metal to go in this knob here, and I super glued it in, and I made sure that everything is turning really nicely here, so I'm gonna put all the knobs back on, and then I think the tuner chassis will be done. Then it will be time to evaluate the power chassis. Welcome to day 3 of working on the Telefunken, and I've decided after all I am going to replace the electrolytic capacitors in this guy. I don't think it'll be that difficult. Typically what I can do is just relocate some of the electrolytics, because all we need to do is find a chassis ground, which is easy. So I'll locate one here, and then I believe the last time I did it, what's that noise? Apparently it's the weird ice cream truck. Well, not making any money off of me today, buddy boy. All right, well, obviously I can't talk over that thing, so I'm going to replace the first one, relocate it here, and I'll just run a jumper wire from the rectifier to here. I don't see how people that drive those things don't go absolutely insane having to listen to that all day long. Okay, so all the electrolytics have been replaced. One I put here, one I shoved down here, and one I just stuck there. There's plenty of room behind this chassis inside the cabinet, so there's lots of room. So I believe that concludes most of the electronic work on the system. And the owner requested that I add an audio input feature, which should be easy. We'll just go in through the tape connection. The tape connections are funny on these things, so I'm going to have to put it back in the cabinet and see what's what. I think what I'm going to do now, since it's nice and sunny out there, is I'm going to clean the cabinet and get that prepped and ready for reassembly. The cabinet's in real good shape on this. It just needs a polish. Okay, now it's time to work on the cabinet. It's in good shape except for this trim. It appears it's plastic coated metal, and underneath the metal has oxidized, and this is about to come off, so I need to glue that back on. In fact, I worked on a previous model of this, and it was missing all that trim, so I think this must have been probably initially a kind of a poor choice. It's not really well put together. What I'm going to do is go over this wooden area here with a little bit of Old English for light woods. I just want to put just a little bit. What am I doing? I already told myself not to get crap on the new driveway, and I'm already doing it. All right. I'm just going to go in here and clean this up, and you're going to see how it kind of like improves that appearance really dramatically, because the wood's really dried out, and we just want to kind of touch it up. There we go. And now what I'm going to do for the rest of it, I'm going to go over it with car wax. I think what I'm doing is actually go over the whole thing with oil, and then I have this mechanical buffer and car wax, and that's going to go on the glossy part of the finish. All right, so I got the whole thing buffed out. It's too bad about this trim, because otherwise it looks like a mirror. I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to get the radio back together, and then I'm going to glue that back in. It looks like it's also shrunk a little bit. You can see it used to go to the corner here, and it's shrunk just enough not to meet that end. So let me put the guts back in. What I want to do is start, I'm going to wire it up the same way I did the last one for incorporating audio input. I want to see if that works. All right, I did find where to hook it up. So now I've got this cable running into the back of these tape inputs. Need to replace the crossover caps too. We got two of these 50 microfarad caps. Replace those, and then it'll be time to start testing, buttoning it up, and make sure everything works. Okay, so I've got the most of the set buttoned back in there, and I got the audio going through. And this thing does sound good, actually. Man that loves you. Good sounding set. Phenomenal sounding, actually. Now what I want to do is fix some of this trim. Meanwhile, I'll have the radio playing, make sure nothing's going to go bad, because this thing's going to go all the way back to Sacramento, and that's an hour and a half away from here. I want to make sure everything works fine. All right.
Chris, let me give you a...
Oakland, Raquel Maria Dillon, KCBS.
Betting to putting.
He also said the biggest problems are more growth related and said he would love to.
When all the things you are mine.
All right, she sounds good. I'm going to have it on for a little bit longer. Then I'll put the back on and inform the client that they can come and collect their radio. They've actually had me fix a few things. I need to fix some Grundig powered speakers, and then they can come and get all of it. But that concludes this episode of Radiorama. Thanks so much for watching. If you have any questions or comments, make sure and leave them down below. If you like this channel and you like what you see, then make sure and press that like button. Tell your friends about it. I don't do this for money or anything. I just do it because it's fun. And I hope you got a kick out of it. All right, guys. I'll see you next time. Adios.